You're listening to Southeast Radio's Business Matters with Carl Fitzpatrick in association with Wexford Insurances. Think Wexford Insurances for your business insurance.
I'm joined now by Neil Hughes, the managing partner of Hughes Blake Chartered Accountants in Enniscorthy and the author of Beating the Recession, The Seven C's of Business Recovery. Good morning, Neil. Before we get started, I'd like to hear a little bit about your own background, please.
Well, Carl, I grew up in Enniscorthy. I went to school in St. Sennans and the Christian Brothers, and before I, you know, went to college in Dublin ultimately. So I'm Enniscorthy through and through. And once I left college up in DCU, I went into training as a chartered accountant, so qualified as a chartered accountant. And during the course of that training, I suppose I would have specialised quite a lot in corporate recovery and in business recovery, because this was coming out of the end of the last recession in the late 80s and early 90s, we're talking about. I'm giving away my age now, but so I suppose that would have been my background and training. So my father, Kevin's practice, was always in Enniscorthy, Hughes McLean Dowling, as it was known at the time. So I joined Kevin in 1997, and we set up Hughes and Associates, and I opened an office for the practice in Dublin, and the office continued on Castle Hill in Enniscorthy, which a lot of people would be familiar with all through those years. So just to bring it right up to date, I suppose, we merged with another Dublin firm back in 2006, which was a long-standing firm called Blake. So we're now Hughes Blake and have been since then.
One of the reasons I asked you to come in and join me this morning is I wanted to discuss the different options that are available to businesses out there that are struggling financially. Maybe if you could take me through the different options firstly, and then we look at each one individually.
Well, this would be something I suppose I'd be well used to, because it's regularly now people would come in to me and you know, my heart would go out to them, quite frankly, Carl, because oftentimes you would find people who can't see the wood for the trees. They'd be under massive pressure. The wolves are at the door. And it's a sort of a pressure cooker environment that people find themselves in now, because we're now, what, three years into the recession, maybe into the fourth year of recession. And a lot of businesses simply can't cope. You know, they've got the bank to deal with. They've got the revenue commissioners that they're trying to keep up to date. And obviously they're trying to keep their suppliers, their, you know, the trade suppliers also, to try and keep supplies coming in so they can keep trading. So it's a particularly difficult situation that I find myself in. And people, they come into my office and they've got a bag of bricks in each hand. And I suppose what I'm trying to do when we speak to them is to try and just set that bag of bricks down so that they can talk about the positive things about their business. And what I would do, the very first thing I suppose that we would do, is I would ask somebody that comes into me to tell me everything positive about their business, all of the good things about their business. Because often that can be lost at the minute, Carl, in the economy, because there's a negative sentiment out there. And that not only just in the media, but in the country as a whole, there is a negative sentiment there. And the sort of the value that's there, the good things about a business can be lost. And the good things I'm talking about, it could be intangible assets, there could be the know-how of employees, there could be brands, there could be name recognition for a business. So there can be a lot of good things in a business which can just completely get missed and lost. And that's what I try and focus on initially. Because once we find out what that is in a business, that core business, the fundamentally good part of the business, that becomes the platform then to try and build a recovery plan for that business. So I suppose to move on then, if you wanted to talk about the different options people have, you know, first of all, once you establish what the business is all about and find out what the positive things are, the good things, the options people have, number one is to try to trade through it, which is what pretty much every business in the country at the minute is trying to do with the recession. And that means putting the head down, working maybe harder than the business had to in 2005, 2006, 2007. It means cutting costs. It means trying to collect in the cash you owed and just trade through it. Try to make a few quid in profit so that you can then try and pay the arrears that you might owe to some of your suppliers. So Carl, the five different options available to businesses are, first of all, trading through it, which is what a lot of businesses are doing at the minute. Secondly, an informal scheme, or a creditor's voluntary arrangement, where, you know, you try and do deals with creditors. Thirdly, then, there is formal schemes of arrangement, and typically that would be done under examinership. Fourthly, then, and this is, I suppose, where shareholder value is lost, but number four is where you invite the appointment of a receiver by the company's bank to try and keep the business trading. And then finally, the very last thing on the list, number five, is liquidation, and that's liquidating the business, and possibly something could rise from the ashes of a business out of a liquidation, but it is difficult, we would find.
If we look at trading through it firstly, lots of businesses are out there today. As you said earlier, they're being put under phenomenal pressure by creditors to be paid, such as the revenue and the banks, not alone their suppliers. What advice would you give to businesses out there in relation to how to trade through it? What do they need to do?
Well, I would say the very first thing they need to do is they should take advice. They should, you know, try and again get a fresh pair of eyes to look at their business to show them maybe what they need from the point of view of a new business plan to try and trade through the recession. You know, people, I think sometimes now, now are using the same approach that they took back in the boom years, where there was more and more fish in the barrel to shoot. At that time, there was so much business going on, and back in the height of the Celtic Tiger. So now I think the first thing people should do is take advice. But then the key, I suppose, advice I would give to people in that scenario is to communicate openly with the people that you owe money to. You'd be amazed, Carl, people would be amazed at the goodwill they'll get back if they would just level with people as to what their real situation is. And I think it's a kind of a Celtic Tiger pride that many people have, that they won't actually just level with the people they're doing business with. I find that men, unfortunately, have failings in this, which perhaps women don't, in my experience. I find that women in business tend to be far more straight about things and more open, and perhaps they have less of the kind of the Celtic Tiger hubris or pride maybe that that men have. And that's just a personal observation, but one way or the other, I think that absolute open, transparent communication is critical if somebody wants to trade through the recession.
You also mentioned an informal scheme. How does that work?
Well, an informal scheme is something whereby you're basically trying to do deals with the different people that the business owes money to. And this might involve, you know, listen, will you settle for half? Like somebody would approach a supplier and say, look, will you settle for half if I pay you upfront now? Or will you settle, maybe, would you take 75% over 6 months or whatever? And there's a huge amount of this going on now, by the way. Like, this is happening in business all the time around the county. And it's successful, largely, you know. This is, I suppose, people are going back to the days of even barter, whereby, you know, if you can't pay for something in cash, well, can I give you goods or services in lieu of what the money that's owed? That's the kind of informal scheme that's going on. Again, absolute openness and transparency to make that work is critical. But we have found those kind of schemes can be difficult to get over the line, because that, you know, sometimes suppliers might hang back and say, well, listen, what's the guy up the road? What's he getting? You know, you're offering me 50 cent on the euro, but what's he getting? You know what I mean? And that's why sometimes people have to move on to the third stage, which is a formal scheme or examinership.
That leads us into examinership, as you say. I know that there were 16 companies entered into examinership last year. Tell me about that process. How does that work?
Well, examinership is Ireland's formal corporate rescue mechanism. You know, America has Chapter 11, and in Ireland it's called examinership. So since 1990, companies that find themselves insolvent, but they're fundamentally good companies, they, under law, you have the right to apply to appoint an examiner to your company. Basically, the examiner goes in to examine the affairs, to work out what is the, you know, the fundamental core of the business that's worth fighting for and worth saving. And then the examiner has to come up with what's called a scheme of arrangement. And that's a package of measures to deal with the liabilities, to deal with perhaps the ongoing trading deficit that might be there, to allow the company, and critically, to allow the jobs of the people that work there, the livelihoods that form the economic activity that's actually providing the ongoing money that circulates around the county and around the country, but to allow that to emerge at the end of the examinership process, or the protection period as it's allowed. So it's a comprehensive protection that is afforded to a company, so that basically to allow it a breathing space to restructure. And the examiner then just shepherds the company through that process. The reality is that if you take property developers out of the examinership figures, examinership statistics, pretty much all of the companies that go into examinership and apply for examinership are approved to go into examinership and can come out the far end. So I think a lot of those property developer cases, unfortunately, were probably misguided applications. And you know the ones I'm talking about, Carl. Companies that had no real prospect of survival, as the property market has continued to just go down and down. I suppose examinership is suitable for trading businesses, you know, businesses that are employing people and providing, you know, economic activity in the community. Those are all good candidates for the examinership process.
What is the cost of examinership?
Well, the upfront cost to get into examinership, you have to instruct a legal team to apply for you. And the cost can be about of the order of 10 to 12K to actually secure examinership for the company. That is the only upfront cost that a business will have to provide, because any costs then thereafter, they form part of that package of measures, that scheme of arrangement I was referring to. So it comes out of, you know, monies that you know are either available for the payment of dividends to creditors or for the ongoing working capital. It all forms part of that package of measures. But it typically, just to give you a broad brushstrokes, that kind of cost might be 12 to 15K per month, depending on how long the examinership lasts. And it can only last up to 100 days. That's the maximum an examinership can last. But it's not an upfront cost. The only upfront cost for a business to secure examinership is of the order of 10 to 12K.
And that cost is in respect of your legal team applying to the High Court to get permission from the courts to enter the company into examinership in the first place.
That's exactly it. It's a solicitor and a barrister needed. And also you need what's called an independent accountant's report as part of that. So there's three different parts to the cost, and they tend to be of the order of maybe 4K per professional that's acting: solicitor, barrister, and an independent accountant.
Why are so few companies entering into examinership?
Well, it's a good question, Carl. And I tell you, my view is, and that's just a personal view, if you have an economy which has a 15 years of a boom, like from 93, 94, right up until 2008, 2009, people just have no idea that examinership exists. And I suppose people are hearing about it now. I think there's going to be more examinerships this year than last. But there still is a really, compared to the US, for example, where it's very common for companies to go into Chapter 11, which is the examinership equivalent, I think there's a very, very few, relatively speaking. And I think that's a dreadful shame, because there's a huge amount of jobs, thousands of jobs, which I think could have been saved if businesses that could have perhaps restructured under the supervision of an examiner. Unfortunately, they went into liquidation and those jobs were lost.
There was over 1,600 companies last year went into liquidation. Do you feel that a high percentage of those could have been saved if they did enter into examinership in the first place?
You take the US statistics, 22% of companies that become insolvent in America enter Chapter 11. And in Ireland, the figure is about 1%, 1 or 2%. So if you just take those broad brushstroke analogy, that broad brushstroke analogy, you will find that in fact probably 200-300, maybe even 400 companies, in my view, could have been saved. There's no reason why we should have different figures to the US. We're like an open market-based economy as the same way as the US is. So that'd be my view. And I think it's tremendously valuable even that, for example, that we can speak about such a positive measure on a programme such as yours, Carl.
Talk me through the process of examinership. Once the courts have agreed for a company to go into examinership, what happens next?
Well, essentially, the examiner goes in. It's up to 100 days. And the examiner doesn't take over the running of the company because that stays with the directors. The examiner's on the outside examining and trying to come up with a scheme and typically would monitor it on a week-to-week basis, trying to come up with this package of measures. That may involve new investment from an outside investor or from the existing principals. It may involve new borrowings from some of the banks that are lending in Ireland, which may be less well known. And these would be the UK working capital providers. There are banks there that are lending, even though our pillar banks perhaps wouldn't lend to somebody with a stressed balance sheet. And the examiner will try and bring together that package of measures, which may involve, you know, cutting some more costs. It may involve changing the way the company does its business and trying to come up with within the 100 days, which is basically 3.5 months, to try and come up with that package of measures to allow the company to come out the far end.
Failing examinership, another next option then is in relation to receivership. How does that work?
Well, basically, a receiver is a creature of the bank, is a creature of the bank's charge or the creature of the bank's debenture. And typically, the bank will appoint a receiver to try and get its money back. Shareholder value ends at stage three, as we were talking about that examinership, because we're into number four now, which is receivership. And shareholder value at that stage is gone. Anything that comes back is for the benefit of the bank. So this is an option which I suppose typically business owners, it's the failure of the business, if that's the case. It's a particularly black day for business owners if the receivers walk in and change the locks. But it is possible, I suppose, to try and again stay reasonably positive on this show, it is possible for a company to re-emerge from receivership. In other words, a business can be bought back from receivership. It can continue to trade in receivership, whereby a receiver and manager is appointed. You know, it may not be all negative, but certainly from shareholder value point of view, when the receiver walks in, that's the end.
There was approximately 100 companies that went into receivership last year. Very, very few of them came out the other side. Usually that scenario is used by the bank to sell off assets to repay the loan.
That's what it is. And in fairness to the banks, I have to say, Carl, they have held the line, particularly the pillar banks, the Irish-owned banks. The same can't be said really for the foreign-owned banks, which people would be familiar with. But largely speaking, the Irish banks, AIB and Bank of Ireland particularly, have held the line. When you take into account the number of insolvent borrowers that they have on their books, they have only appointed a handful of receivers over the last couple of years. That's quite extraordinary, really, about how few receivers have been appointed by AIB and Bank of Ireland. And I think that's to their credit, quite frankly. And maybe they don't get enough credit for that. But at the same time, you know, there are a lot of companies that have gone into receivership, which is a shame. I suppose a receiver doesn't have an obligation to try and save jobs in the same way as the examiner. That's the examiner's sole job, is to try and make sure the job survives, the company survives and the jobs. But a receiver's job is to get the bank's money back. And if that means just selling the assets, well, then that's what it'll be.
In many cases, does the company actually invite the bank to appoint a receiver, or is it done on an involuntary basis?
It does happen that the directors will realise that they have no option. And if they want to continue in any form, they have to invite the bank to appoint a receiver. That does happen. But the majority of cases, a receiver is appointed where the bank has lost confidence in the business, lost confidence in the management of the business. So they send in the receivers to change the locks. So oftentimes it would be a hostile process.
So failing the receivership process, you're then into liquidation. Let's talk about voluntary and involuntary liquidation.
We're at the end of the line now, I suppose, with the whole corporate recovery cycle, if you know what I mean. And liquidation is where a business just ceases to trade. It has to pull the shutters down. And then 10 days later, the creditors are called together to appoint a liquidator. And that's what's known as a voluntary liquidation process, where the directors voluntarily call together creditors and say, we need to appoint a liquidator. And then it is possible as well with a what's called a court liquidation or a compulsory liquidation for somebody that's owed money. For example, the revenue would regularly petition to appoint liquidators to companies. And that's a court liquidation where they would seek to appoint a liquidator or to have a judge appoint what's called an official liquidator to a company. That happens as well. It's not as frequent, though, because, again, you're into the cost that we talked to earlier about petitioning the courts to try and do that. And it can be of the order of 10K to actually have a creditor appoint a liquidator in the courts. So it's more common that the companies, if they are being wound up, they're wound up by voluntary liquidation.
Just to look at banks for a second, from your experience, how supportive have banks been of companies that are out there struggling?
Well, as I said, the pillar banks, I have found they have been very supportive. But there's one issue, Carl, which is, I suppose, something that people need to be aware of. And that is if they are seeking to restructure. We've seen a number of examples where if you approach a bank to restructure an existing facility, that facility may have an attractive rate built into it. It may be a rate of, say, 1% over Euribor. Or maybe a small bit more, 1-1.5% over Euribor. And that's the kind of rates that were given out at the height of the Celtic Tiger. But I can tell you one thing for absolute certainty. The banks are seeking to change those rates and put the rates up. And if they are given the opportunity to do that by way of, you know, a request for a restructure, it's likely the rate will go up to maybe 2, maybe 3% over Euribor. That can have a devastating effect on a business's chances to beat the recession and get through the far end of the recession. So I would suppose the advice we would have to give to anybody in that scenario, if they have an attractive rate, they should do whatever it takes to keep it. Because over the life of the loan, it could be in the many hundreds of thousands that that will cost if they shift off that rate. And in fact, it may be one of the great intangible assets of the business that they have is that attractive rate they have. In the same way, by the way, anybody that has a tracker mortgage at 1% over Euribor, again, is one of the great intangible assets they have. It could be worth 100 grand over the course of the life of the loan. So if there's any other way, by way of short-term borrowings or whatever, that they can keep that rate, well, then that's what they should do, because they will benefit hugely in the long run.
So what you're saying is if somebody, for instance, has a commercial mortgage, owes €1 million on it, is looking for the likes of an interest-only period, certainly do not enter into an agreement to restructure that loan under a new term with a new higher interest rate, if at all possible. What options are available to somebody in that regard as an option not to go with a new agreement?
Well, the first thing they should do is take advice as to what's happening, because I wouldn't by any means just sign the first thing that the bank manager puts in front of you and pause for, you know, a few days, go and take advice from somebody that can actually talk you through what the implications are. But if it's possible to get short working capital sort of borrowings to try and keep the payments on a facility, on an attractive facility, up to date, you know, that could be by way of, you know, other working capital facilities they have, the overdraft or, you know, a shorter term loan, or possibly some of the, as I said, the working capital invoice discounting providers that are out there. They should try and do that first, because if they work out what is actually going to cost us over the long term, they may find out that, in fact, signing up that new facility, it could well be a death sentence for the company.
Before we finish, I just want to have a quick chat to you about your book, Beating the Recession, The 7 C's of Business Recovery. What are those 7 C's?
Well, the 7 C's, counsel is the first, and that's taking advice, as we said, critically important for somebody that can't see the wood for the trees. But going on from that then, communication is, we have found, it's the watchword really for trying to beat the recession, and that is levelling with the people you owe money to. People would be amazed at the goodwill they'll get back if they would just level with the creditors that are there. Cooperation is critical between all of the staff members, bringing the staff into a room and explaining exactly what, you know, the recovery plan is going to involve. And then pausing and saying, we need clarity of purpose. And that's a new business plan, because a lot of people don't have that clarity. They need to pause, take advice and put a new business plan in place that deals with the effects of the recession. And then you're into implementation. And then the final 3 C's then are cutting your costs, making sure that an ongoing deficit like we have in Ireland Inc. at the minute, making sure that's not in your business, collecting your cash, and that's focusing on credit control, because he who shouts loudest at the moment is the one that's getting paid. And finally, your customers and clients, focusing on customer service, because people won't put up with poor customer service anymore, not in this day and age, because people have, you know, they can vote with their feet, they can move elsewhere. And that's the golden rule of beating the recession, is focusing on excellent customer service.
Neil, it's been a pleasure speaking with you this morning, and it's certainly been a very informative interview, so thanks for coming in.
You're listening to Southeast Radio's Business Matters with Kyle Fitzpatrick in association with Wexford Insurances. Think Wexford Insurances for your business insurance.